One of the things that's been going on in my head lately is exactly that, is from Isaiah 6:8. You know, I heard of a voice from the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send?" And I said, "Here am I, Lord, send me." And it never fails. Nobody is ready to go unless if they're prepared and ready to go. Amen? I mean, we just can't do it. If we are not prepared and if we are not ready to answer that call, then we have to prepare ourselves. We have to get ready. Unless if you totally don't want God to call on you for anything, then you're probably in a safe mode this morning. I don't know. Jeremiah 29:13 says, "You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart." This is a huge text because basically what it's saying is, we'll find God. If we are truly seeking after God with all our heart, we will find him. That's a promise from Scripture. If we are not seeking with all our heart, chances are you might not find him. Now, the coolest thing was that the song we did this morning, God, you know, how God loves us. I want to think, how do you love God? How much do you love God? Christina and I got married 33 years ago, this last March. And if I were to describe or ask you guys to answer questions on how I showed my love over those years, what would you say? Tell me some of the things you'd ask me. This is the interaction time. Did I what? Did I woo her? Ooh, I like that. Did I do the dishes? Did I serve her? Okay. What else? What are those, some of the questions you might ask?
Did you tell her you love her?
Did I tell her I love her? Did I what? Did I make her breakfast? Okay. Did I take care of her when she was sick? Do I rub her feet? I think your questions are done. Do I ever go to bed mad? Yeah. Very good.
Did you put her first?
Did I put her first? Okay. All great questions. Think about those questions we just asked. Now, how are we, our love for God? If someone were to say, how did you demonstrate your love for your God? Did I serve her? Not necessarily make her breakfast, but serve her. Did I rub her feet? Well, I didn't rub God's feet. Do I serve God? Do I put him first? Did I woo him? You see how that relates with one another? When you think about the deepest love that you've ever had in your life, and you relate that with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and God our Father, you can't go wrong. But do you do that? So this question this morning is, how much of God do you really want? What are you content with? Wilbur Reese, he's an author, he wrote this in one of his books. He said, "I would like to buy $3 worth of God, please. Not enough to explode my soul or disturb my sleep, but just enough to equal a cup of warm milk or a snooze in the sunshine. I want ecstasy, not transformation. I want the warmth of the womb, not a new birth. I want a pound of the eternal in the paper sack. I would like to buy 3 pounds of God bless." That really hit me hard. I mean, just reading that again. I read that years ago. But just reading that again, are we just asking for $3 worth of God? Just enough? You see, if we're truly want to be the ones who are saying, "God, here am I," we have to be seeking more than three pounds. $3 worth of God. John 4:14. This is the woman at the well. Jesus says, "But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. This is a promise of God. Those who drink of the water. You know, a lot of people say, you've got a hard job. And they're surprised to find out the hardest part of my job isn't necessarily counseling with people who are have issues going on, getting calls at the middle of the night, hospital visits, things like that. Or even writing a sermon. Writing a sermon is probably the easiest thing that I do in the ministry, to be honest with you. Because I don't write one. I pray, I study, I research, and I let the Holy Spirit deliver. So that's easy to me. The hardest part, humanly, as I see it, is when people in my congregation become dehydrated spiritually. They come out of the gate really strong, and they accept Christ as their personal Savior. And as they go on, it's like someone who's dying of thirst, and they have gallons of water right in front of them. That's the hardest part, is watching someone become dehydrated spiritually. They forget about the well. They forget about that water that springs up to eternal life is a continuous thing. And we can go to it and draw from it all the time. To me, that's such an encouragement. Because when I become spiritually thirsty, that's what I go to. Jackson came to me this morning and asked me about the Beatitudes, what was special about them. In Matthew 5:6, this is one of the greatest ones. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Do we search for righteousness? You see, there's a lot of people that are not hungry or thirsty for righteousness. They don't understand it. They're dehydrated and they're starving, I guess, and they're malnutrition spiritually, but they're not sure why. I'm gonna use an illustration here this morning. I'm back to my youth illustrations. I don't know if that's telling me something or what, but no, I don't have any horse manure this week. I have two of my favorite drinks. Lemonade. Everybody like lemonade? I love lemonade. It's good stuff. And I got Frappuccino. Anyone like Frappuccino? Gotta shake this dude up, though. But to me, I just want to illustrate this a little bit. I love lemonade, right? I love Frappuccino. I should have went through this before you. But think about our spiritual lives. We wake up in the morning and go, but you still have 90% done. I only have about 10% of sin. Scripture, lukewarm. Either be hot or cold. Either I'm going to spew you out of my mouth. But I think it goes even a little deeper than that. Because we're trying to incorporate something that's separating us from God, with God. Some of the people I talk to say the most miserable people that they know are church people, are Christians. I'm thinking, oh, man. I'm thinking, why is that? Right there, I think. Don't you? I mean, how can you be joy and happy if you know your soul is struggling with something in your life? I mean, if you have God in one hand and you're trying to hang on to another, and I believe that's a wholeheartedly way that we're going to only be able to hear God's call to go. If we confront that. Now, we did a few weeks ago about me just being real. But the more I look at it, the more I dwell on it. Because there's an example in Revelation, book of Revelation. And it's from Revelation 3. And it's the Sardis, the church of Sardis. It says, the angel of the church in Sardis, write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy. The one who is victorious will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but will acknowledge the name before my Father and his angels. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This is one of the arguments, to be honest, folks, if you can lose your salvation. If it's a possibility to lose your salvation, I believe you can. I believe you can. I mean, you're walking away from God. Either that, or the argument is you never had a relationship with God. So one or the other, it is. So if you look at Revelation again, it says people thought. Let's hear. I want to make sure I get this right here. It says, I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. You see, there's a lot of churches, I believe, out there. And not just our church. I'm not saying our church. I'm saying the church, the body of Christ out there. They're going through a lot of this stuff. They have a reputation of being alive, but they're dead. I mean, they are totally dead, spiritually dead. So if you're spiritually dead, we can't be spiritually alive, right? You see, you can't drink from here and drink from here and drink from here and drink from here. And believe that you have spiritually alive being persecuted in you. I mean, you cannot believe that. Galatians 5:16-17, I think it is. Says, so I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you will not to do whatever you want. Spirit and the flesh. They want different things. You see, you got to put your spiritual hat when you want to get rid of the worldly things, when you want to get rid of the fleshy things. You have to do that. You have to walk in the Spirit. You have to grab on to it. But a lot of people say, well, you know, I got time. I mean, I'm a good person. Spiritually, I believe I'm there. Okay? Scripture says to those who are walking in the Spirit, those who have not repented, those who have not came to the Lord and said, Lord, I want your forgiveness, and then change your ways. That's when you get before the throne of God when you die, and he says, be gone, because I don't know who you are. I don't want to be one that says, yeah, but the people on earth think I'm good, and I made it. We have to think about our salvation for a moment. We're doing a book right now on A.W. Tozer called Prayer. And it talks about that, being just ones who are comfortable, content with how we are and where we're at. And he encourages us to push forward into a new depth of a relationship with Jesus Christ. Pray differently. Read Scripture differently. Do things differently than what we've ever done before. To me, we need to look, are we hungry and thirsty for the Lord? Are we ones who are actually going to the well and being refreshed? Or are we spiritually hungry and starving and thirsty with water and food right in front of us? I don't want to get to that point. And I don't want to be that person at 90%. I hang on to my 10%. Do I? Yeah. And it makes me sick. You see, when I get before my Lord, I know what I'm doing wrong. He knows what I'm doing wrong. None of your people's business. And same with you and me. It's none of my business. My business is to give you the Word of God. It's my business to make sure that you know the truth. I don't believe in sugarcoating stuff. If we are not walking in the Spirit, we're walking out of the Spirit. We can't expect to receive all that God has if we're using them just when we need them. How much of God do you really want? Are you hungry and thirsty for what he has for you? I want to be thirsty and hungry for the Lord. I never want to be totally content. I want to go to that well often and always. I want people to be coming to me because I'm overflowing from the fountain. And they're feeding off of that. I don't want to be false. I don't want to be fake in what I'm doing and how I'm doing things. I don't want to be like the Church of Revelation, because these are warnings. This is John warning the church. This is Jesus Christ. These are red letters who said this stuff this morning. People say you're alive, but you're really dead. And that's individual, because who's the church? We are the church. Those are different ones within this church body this morning that people think are spiritually alive. But you're not. There's one way to cure that. One cure, and that's it. David said it. Psalms 27. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek Him in His temple. That's all I want to do. Dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You see, your bodies are a spiritual temple for the Holy Spirit. So the home of the Lord is within you. When you call on the Spirit of God to interact with you and to empower you, you're asking God to use you for everything He has. But we can't do it if we're a tainted vessel. We have to clean it. We have to get rid of it. And that's where He says, repent. Repent and change. He doesn't say, I'm going to throw you out. He doesn't say you've screwed up so many times that you're no good. He says, I'm going to send my Son for you. And He's going to cleanse you. And He's going to clean you up. And He's going to save you. And He's going to give you salvation. Because there's nothing you can do. But we have to go. And we have to seek Him. Just as you are. However you are, wherever you are, God comes to you. He puts His hand out there. He grabs onto you. He says, are you ready to go? Are you done playing games? Are you done talking the talk? Are you willing to start doing it? That's where it becomes a choice. Of saying, I'm all in. Or I'm part of, or I'm all out. I mean, it's really a choice. God seeks you and seeks you and seeks you. Eventually, we have to respond. We can't do it halfway. And there's going to be times that sin creeps back into you. What you do? Get on your knees again. Repent again. Change again. That's where the grace of God comes in. His love and mercy. But we can't live on His love and mercy alone. Because it becomes a crutch. You see, if we just look at that, we think we can live however we want, do whatever we want, however we want, and still be secure. I don't believe that's the case. And if you want to argue the debate scripture, I'll debate it. Because there's some in here that basically say that you'll have, you know, salvation forever. But I don't want to take a chance. See, my line is right here. I stay over here. I don't want to get close to that. I don't want my name in the book of life taken away, because that's what Scripture just told us, is it taken out. What's been given can be taken away. I mean, that's scriptural. I think we got to really, really push God out of our life in order for that to happen. Don't get me wrong. But you also have to take a spiritual inventory. $3 worth of God. Not enough to explode my soul or disturb my sleep.